Through the years and through her restaurant, Leah Chase has turned hospitality into an art form. Who else could have transformed a lottery and sandwich shop into a white tablecloth restaurant and a fine art gallery, all in the middle of the 6th Ward in Treme? While she has a sharp eye for art and a soft spot for up-and-coming artists, it's always been the people in the community Leah Chase has had at heart. At the corner of Orleans and North Miro, she's had the best of both worlds for the last 70 years. If you just looked at the walls, it'd be hard to tell this is a restaurant and not an upscale art gallery.
I don't think there's any restaurant in America that has a fine collection of contemporary American art. Not just African American art, American art at all. I can't think of any restaurant that I know of. Maybe a couple in Las Vegas.
My mother will look around at this art that she has here, and I think she is just truly appreciative of the creative spark, genius, that these folks show in committing this thought to canvas, this thought to music, this thought to whatever it is that they're doing, from cooking on down.
The thought was the fine art on the walls may encourage people to wear their finery when dining at Dookie Chase Restaurant.
She thought of herself as, yes, being that grand dame that had a place where people thought of dressing up when they came to visit.
Yeah.
And seeing a place with cloth napkins and beautiful art on the walls. And of course, you always hear music in the background.
Leah Chase also fashions herself an artist with her pots and pans as the canvas and fresh ingredients as her medium.
My mind only tells me about some food in a pot and how to put it in a pot, but it would never tell me how to put it on paper, how to show you what I'm thinking on paper. And I think that's great.
Expressing herself and telling a story with each recipe she puts on a plate, much like the vast collection of paintings that adorn her walls.
I think about Miss Chase looking at the work. It's about, yes, it was like a scrapbook, I would say. So these are like all moments in times, and all these artists were telling stories.
All her best friends are artists. We talked about art. Clifton is the person who was always the go-to person, Mr. Reliable.
Well, I hung them all. I hung them from the beginning till now. It was my wife and I, Joe. We did this together. That was her picture hanger, you know. Friend and picture hanger, yeah.
While Clifton Webb was hanging her pictures, Leah Chase was rubbing elbows with the who's who in the art community.
Very early on, I met a wonderful woman named Celestine Cook, who was a real mover and shaker in the black community. But she was the one who introduced me to Leah. She says, there's someone here who would you should get involved in the museum. And I guess that was about the mid-70s.
Leah Chase served on the board of the New Orleans Museum of Art.
I didn't know one blooming thing. I did not know one thing about art at all. And when Celestine said, I'm going to put you on this board, I said, Celestine, I don't know anything about this.
She was a quick study and simply eager to know more.
Her involvement with the art world was part passion and part pragmatism. She was friends with many artists who had nowhere to show their work. With all the clientele that passed through the restaurant, she decided to make her main dining room a showroom for art you wouldn't see anywhere else.
If you ask an African American, it's like, where's your artwork? You couldn't readily say at this museum here or this location there. Now you can say that, but at the time you could say, You can see my work at Dookie Chase. I feel some ownership in the place, and it's not because of my work on the walls, but I feel the ownership like, gee, I'm a part of something that's actually bigger than myself.
Sometimes an artist through the work of art can symbolize in something as delicate as a piece of art or colors, something strong about maybe Elizabeth Catholic's movie of the mother with the shareholder son. you know, or Samela Lewis' picture of a field worker. That strength that you see, that dignity, that's what she loves.
She got to meet them. She got to meet them all. Those people that are on the walls, for the most part, she got to meet them and fell in love with what they did and what they do, and wanted to have it as a part of her collection.
The pictures on my wall, the paintings are done by people that come my way, and when I look at their paint, I remember the little thing that they left me. Mel Edwards came to see me last week. I was so happy to see him. He's now in his 80s, in his early 80s, but still working, still doing fine. And, you know, you feel good when you look at their work, and it talks to you. You know, it just talks to you all the time.
She catered countless art openings without charge and fed artists when they were hungry. The art created by those friends still speaks to her today. Her collection is wide-ranging, with subject matter that speaks to the human condition or the Southern experience.
Like those cotton pickers there. Now that is by a Caucasian artist. But I have it there because I look at that and it shows me the strength of Black women. This is the master weighing up the cotton. Poor little Black man just is humble, but look at that Black woman. Look, she's looking at him. You better not make a mistake on this cotton. You better not mess up my cotton.
Just as she commands her kitchen, she keeps one particular painting on the wall as a reminder of her no-nonsense approach to running her restaurant.
I keep things to remind me of things. You know, if you go in my dining room, you see a portrait of General Patton, worst general in the world, I guess. But, you know, he was rough, tough. I met his first aide, Colonel Stillman, and he brought me a chart, charted my life against Patton's life. I said, Colonel, I'm not like Patton. I don't curse like Patton. He said, but you drive. You're just driven like him. He said, that John is another one. John, for some reason or another, he had some falling out with some priest, and he didn't agree with the priest, though. You know how people always stop going to church because of this priest. I said, John, the priest, whatever you have, it's the priest. It's not the church. Get your back to church. When John died, I really began to look at his work. Well, John, with his work and what he did every day, he was more spiritual than I could ever be, going to church all the time. So it taught me sometimes it's not about going to church, it's what you think up here and how you live to help others in whatever you do.
When it comes to her collection, you'll find some surprises, like this picture of rapper Tupac Shakur that was given to her by her grandson. Leah Chase was captivated by his story, so this picture is on display. And Miss Leah, I ain't mad at you.
Tupac Shakur. I never met Tupac, but when I read about him and I saw a piece of art, a poem by him, I began to think, what happened to this man? He was so talented, so talented. But I keep Tupac's picture on a drawing done by my grandson. I keep it up there to remind me, never walk on anybody.
Don't ask me where this Tupac thing came from. She asked me, and this is something I never thought I'd hear my mother say. She says, what time is that movie about Biggie and Tupac coming on? I went, what? I went, Biggie and who? Who even knew my mother knew about Biggie Smalls and Tupac?
Whether it's art imitating life or vice versa, all of the pieces that hang on her walls have special places in her heart, including one that reminds her of her beloved Dookie playing the trumpet.
Now, some people will look at this. The little boys are playing. It's not proper to puff out. Dookie was a puffer when he played. And I like that, the two little boys just showing one another how to do it. And that's what it's all about. One shows this one, one shows that one, and you grow.
But you can't be an art lover like Leah Chase without loving the artist. And when it comes to entertainers, Leah Chase's Rolodex likely rivaled that of any music industry executive at the time. The biggest musical acts of the day would call Leah. After taking center stage, they wanted a seat at the table.
Sarah Vaughan, yeah. Oh, she was a sweetheart. Sarah Vaughan, Mahalia Jackson, Lena Horne, Count Basie, all those people, Duke Ellington, all those people out there, that Michael Jackson and his crew. I fed them every time they came through this city. The man who was their bodyguard when he came down here. And then he would always go visit them in California. And I would send sweet potato pies for Michael. And that really upset me when Michael died. I say, I should have sent Michael his sweet potato pies. To me, anything to make him happy.
She knew her celebrity clients so well, she always remembered their orders and their idiosyncrasies.
See, like when Sarah would come, Sarah Vaughan, she liked what she called crab cakes. They were really not crab cakes, they were stuffed crabs. Sarah would sit out there and order two to eat here and two to go. And Cecily Tyson was the same way. Cecily was a ticket eater. She liked crab meat, loved her crab meat. I can go back and tell you what everybody liked. And that's a good feeling when you gave somebody something that makes them happy.
It's almost like it's something old that's being revisited, but it was, she believes in giving and sharing what she had.
If variety truly is the spice of life, then Leah Chase is well-seasoned, and that's part of her charm. Just as comfortable with Hollywood A-listers as she is with heads of state, you just never know who's going to walk through those doors.
Solange was a sweetheart, little girl. I love her to death. She would eat anything I give her. But Beyonce, they like seafood, and they ate a lot of seafood, shrimp Clemenceau, and maybe some fish, things like that. Things that they don't get every day.
I met Oprah Winfrey. I met President Barack Obama, President Bush, met Beyonce, met Mr. JC. I've met Miss Cecily Tyson. My all-time favorite was Miss Wilma Rudolph. So you don't get starstruck, but it's just an honor to say that I've actually been under the same roof as these people.
A bow put chili in her gumbo. This motherly attitude that she had about people. She said, you know, he's skinny, we need to fatten him up.
He was looking a little skinny. And the last time he came, poor darling, his hair was white as mine.
Leah Chase cooks from her heart food that'll feed your soul.
So she'll say you look skinny or you look tired or they're not feeding you. So anytime somebody comes in, she wants to give you her love.
It's love that simmered down, seasoned to perfection, and served up on plates in her dining room. Even with all her success, she never takes it for granted. The tough times growing up are never far from mind.
Take like President George W. Bush. He wasn't the greatest president going, but a kinder man you're never gonna find. I remember in high school standing on a corner in the French Quarter waiting to see Franklin Roosevelt pass by and go eat at Antoine's.
When she feeds the president, she has to feed everybody in the motorcade, all the press, everything. So when she said, I'm sending the president chicken and gumbo, we're preparing food for 80 people, because that's just what she does, you know? And that's her way of passing on her love, is through her food.
If there's one thing Leah Chase knows how to do, it's please the palates of whoever comes through her restaurant's doors. The restaurant has always catered to people, even its early clientele, who just stopped by to pick up a sandwich and play the lottery. Leah Chase always remembered their orders and their lucky numbers. Through the years, she's made some upgrades to the restaurant, but service is now, as it has always been, at the heart of what she does, making every effort to ensure your experience in her dining room is 4-star. But in Miss Leah's kitchen, you're on her turf and you do things her way. When Leah J started working in the kitchen of her in-laws' sandwich shop, the food wasn't the only attraction. People knew they would leave with their bellies full, but hopefully their pockets too.
Now in this city, gambling was illegal. So we did pretty good being illegal. That's what made this restaurant. He sold lottery. That's how he made his money, selling lottery. We didn't say red numbers. That's a Chicago thing, a numbers runner. We called it a lottery vendor. So that's sophisticated, interesting, but it was a numbers runner.
It was a working man's eatery just across the street from the then Lafitte Housing Project. Her regular customers were laborers and longshoremen who packed her restaurant once a week to cash their paychecks and order food to go.
I run into people all the time that grew up in the Lafitte area, and they'll come back into the restaurant 20, 25 years later, and they'll say, "Miss Chase, do you remember who I am?" She's right on it. "Yeah, you're so-and-so's son, and I remember your father. He used to send you when you were young to pick up his po' boy sandwich, and we used to give you a Coke."
The rapport she had with her neighbors was outstanding, because they always looked out for you. You know, they always say, "Oh, you know, we're going to look out for you." And she'll tell you that it was never a moment that she was frightful walking home that time in the morning.
They take care of me. You know, they really do.
At the time, the restaurant was open every day of the week with late night hours on the weekends.
The restaurant used to open at 10:30 every morning, 7 days a week. But on Saturday, it would stay open until 5 in the morning. So we would get all the musicians coming from the French Quarter. Over the weekend after they performed in the French Quarter, they'd come right here to this bar.
Eventually, cash and checks and running numbers gave way to sit-down meals in a packed dining room. Leah had started to refine the menu and redefine the restaurant, making changes that had her seeing red.
So that's it. We got to get rid of this pink and blue in here. That's not going to work. So I started putting red on the walls. Red. I like red. Give it some color. Give it some life on the wall.
If these walls could talk, they would have stories to tell. If the doors are open at Dookie Chase Restaurant, you can be assured that Leah Chase is in the kitchen.
I'm just going to glaze these carrots.
And some people think, wow, she's at 95 still cooking, but that's literally what keeps her going, her passion, what keeps her focused. And I think as she continues to do that, we'll be talking the same conversation at 100. Like, can you believe she's still in the kitchen at 100?
Keeping her motor running and her menu ever changing. Today, it's collard greens.
Somebody left me these collard greens and I have to use them. So, and nobody likes plain collard greens, not the Creoles. So I boil the collard greens with ham in it, give it flavor. I saute them down and turn that off. That's ready to go. So you got to give that some kind of oomph and make a white bean and collard green stew. I hope it tastes good. I just didn't know what to do with those dumb collard greens. Let's see how much water you have in those greens. Pull it up.
I've been here for 37 years. It's quite chaotic, actually, but after working with her for a while, I've learned her patterns and can pretty much pick her out.
When you've been in the kitchen as long as Leah Chase has, many of the recipes are second nature, but some may be created on the spot depending on the freshest ingredients at the time. It's the new recipes, though, that can be a challenge.
Sometimes it gets rough in this kitchen because, as I said, I don't write things down and people don't understand where I'm coming from. That's the red bell pepper? Okay, come on. So that's why I have to work, because nobody knows what's in my head. So they have to wait till it comes out of my head, and sometimes that's where the problems start.
She won't give you a heads up as to what's going on, and you have to sit in the wings and wait, and then you go on to do the normal things that you have to do, and then she's going to catch you about 45 minutes before it's showtime, and then she's going to throw it at you. And I think she does it just to see if you're going to unravel.
Unraveling is not an option, especially when you have a following that's unwavering. Often, the line stretches out of the door with people looking to get a seat in her dining room. With that kind of popularity, Leah Chase keeps on pushing. Not even her family can convince her to slow down.
That's good.
People would look at me, are you a masochist? Your mother's still working and you're retired? But then I said, you know, my mother's working because my mother's a free woman and she does what my mother wants to do and nobody's going to tell her any difference. She wants to go to work, she goes to work.
And work she does, often clocking double the hours of a regular shift, and those are the days she's at her best.
See, when I leave out of here and I have had a 16-hour day, I feel good. But I leave out of here with a 4-hour day, not happy. Not happy. You see, and I put this greens and these beans in there. I sauteed these peppers, yellow peppers, red peppers, carrots, leeks. And I put that in there just for color. If things look good, they're going to taste good. If they don't look good, you're not going to even taste them.
When you visit the restaurant, many people often want to take a peek inside the kitchen to see a living legend at work.
First of all, that she's even still coming to the restaurant. Their most shocking thing when they do come in and get a chance to meet her, and they're like, you're still cooking. And her big thing is, of course I am. I'm still living. So it's an integral part of her life.
Let me see that, if the water's cooking out of there. Fire it up high. Your vegetables are cooking too much.
People who know my mother know she will not do anything else but show up every day at this restaurant. So often we're not open because we realize if we're open, my mother's going to be here.
Lunch service at Dookie Chase is the restaurant's bread and butter. But Leah Chase would love to have a dinner service as well, because when it comes to fine dining, dinner is when you break out your best recipes.
I need to open up for dinner, and I'm going to do that. You know, you can't do anything with lunches. You accommodate your customer, I think, at lunch. Dinner, people are going to buy wine, they're going to buy a drink before dinner, all that kind of stuff.
She wants to open up more, and that's right, at her age. And I'm going like, oh my goodness, we will open on Saturdays very soon in 2018, but she also wants to open on Thursday nights.
I got to get open on Saturday nights and Thursday nights. To me, because I like to do dinners. I were able to give them their fish course, move their dishes, come with their little palate cleanser. As the Creoles used to call it, I like all that fion. Years ago, she likes all that fion, but all that is part of eating to me. It makes people happy.
She wants to give you the service that a king or queen may have had in the height of their kingdom or queendom.
After all, she is the queen of Creole cuisine, a reputation earned through hard work. So when you ask her about taking it easy, Leah Chase is not interested.
My children say, why don't you just lie down today? I would be miserable.
Her least favorite thing in the world is not to be here, and also to actually have nothing to do, nowhere to go.
That's because she just doesn't know any other way. You see, hard work has been hardwired into her ever since she was a little girl.
My daddy always told me, you're supposed to work until you die. So I'm gonna work until I die. That's it. I'm coming here to work every day. Toss the carrots in, put a little salt in it. And you see, I used this collard greens and made something out of it. Made bean stew out of it. And in there I have ham and some smoked sausage. So it looks good. So when it goes on the line, it's good.
So now you've heard her story, and if you're lucky, you've tasted her food. For decades, Leah Chase has served up the perfect mix that always seems to hit the spot. It is a story of success built through hard work and sweetened by love. A combination like no other that's helped to bridge racial gaps and brought people from around the world to her table. While food may be her passion, her legacy certainly extends far beyond the kitchen. From the arts to philanthropy, Leah Chase does it all with a sass and a smile that only she could pull off, surrounded by family and inspired by love. For more than 7 decades, she's been creating meals that fill us up and feed our souls. And we're still hungry for what's next. Leah Chase calls New Orleans home, and we call her the queen of Creole cuisine.